evening. We'll call to order the regular meeting of the Lakeport City Council
for Tuesday, January 17th, 2017. Roll call.
Councilmember Barnes?
Here.
Councilmember Parlett?
Here.
Councilmember Spur?
Present.
Mayor Bettina?
Here.
Councilmember Turner is absent.
Okay. Let's do the Pledge of Allegiance next. Councilmember Parlett, will you lead us?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, welcome everyone. Thanks for joining us. Don't have a full house tonight, but if anyone has some input, we have citizen input forms at the back of the room. Or if you're here to speak on an item on the agenda, you just wait for that agenda item to come up. Acceptance of the agenda.
Madam Mayor, I move to for acceptance of the agenda.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have the consent agenda. Ordinances, waive the reading except by title of any ordinance under consideration at this meeting for either introduction or passage. The minutes, approve the minutes of the regular city council meeting of January 3rd. And the warrants, approve the warrant registers of December 20th, 2016 and January 5th, 2017. Anything anyone wants to pull or any questions? Anyone from the public? Okay, we'll look for a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Madam Mayor, I move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, public presentations. Do we have any citizen input tonight?
No.
Okay. Introduction of new employees. We have a new finance director, and do you want to do that one first?
I'll start with that. Yeah. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'd like to introduce Nick Walker. Where are you, Nick? Okay. Come on up so everybody can see you, and we can get you on camera so the public can see you. Nick is our new finance director. He started last Monday. He was born and raised in Lake County. He graduated from Sonoma State with a Bachelor's of Science in Business Administration with an emphasis in accounting. He's worked for Roberts & Associates, a CPA firm, for over 7 years in public accounting, primarily auditing government and not-for-profit entities. And he's passed all the sections of his uniform CPA exam. And it's just and has its application and just waiting for the licensing process to go through. So it's Nick is also a father of two young children. He enjoys the outdoors, backpacking, weight training, but very, very sadly he leads Dodger Blue. So We welcome Nick. He's been a great asset already. He's only been here last week, and he's just like catching on everything so quickly. And Jenny is staying on for a little while to help the mentoring. So we're pleased to introduce Nick Walker to the council and to the community. And Nick, do you want to say anything? Or?
I don't think so. I look forward to working with you guys, and it should be fun.
Great. Welcome. That's what I thought.
How was Nick with that PowerPoint?
Yeah, I know. I
Does he have a master's degree in PowerPoint like
Let's see. Financial Services Specialist Shannon Delgado. Who's going to do that one?
Nick's I'll go ahead and introduce Shannon. This is Shannon Delgado, our new financial specialist one, whose primary responsibility will be cashiering and customer service at the front window. She took up a career in banking and finance over 20 years ago and recently came to us from Wells Fargo, where she had over 13 years of experience. She grew up in Folsom, California. and prior to settling here in Lakeport for the last 13 years, her husband and her two daughters enjoy spending time enjoying the lake, fishing but not swimming. She enjoys cooking and gardening, even though the ground squirrels enjoy the veggies more than they do. Her free time is mostly involved with her kids' sports activities in 4-H, where they raise rabbits this year and will attempt to raise chicken next year. She is very excited to be part of the city of Lakeport and can't wait to start this new journey and learn a different side of finance.
Great. Welcome.
Welcome, Shannon.
Thank you. Do you have a speech prepared?
Oh, no. I'm really excited to be here.
Great.
Shannon's doing an awesome job already at our window up there. The customers are, you can tell they're really loving having her there. So.
Has she had any challenging customers up there lately?
She didn't have any challenging customers.
Very well.
Isn't that fun?
That was really bad.
It's your fault.
So Shannon's our first face to the city, so it's wonderful to have somebody with her experience with customer service. So it's great.
Yeah, it's very important.
Very nice. Okay, Doug, are you on the next one?
Yes, I'd like to introduce you to Chris Pion. He is our new water systems operator, too. Chris is starting his career into the water systems operations. We're his first full-time position as a water operator. And we're really excited because he's very enthusiastic and energetic about learning our system and being part of a team. We hired him on November 14th, and he's been doing extremely well. And he's going to really luck out because I don't have a big long list of all those other things.
I'm just wondering, does that mean we get to pick out hobbies for him?
Yeah. But, unfortunately, Paul was going to be here to introduce Chris, and unfortunately, he's not able to be with us this evening. But he'll get to introduce Larry, because Larry was unfortunately unable to be here as well.
Okay. So,
and then we could always bring Chris back and we could give him the whole rundown.
Oh, yeah.
So, Chris, you don't have to deal with Forrest Dogner, I hope.
Oh, he's my direct supervisor.
Oh, I'm sorry. Forrest's a good friend of mine. I don't know what kind of boss he's going to be, but I think you're going to be challenged.
Welcome.
Thank you.
He's a new uncle.
Oh, yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Welcome aboard.
We expect pictures.
Welcome.
All right. Moving on to Council of Business. Public Works. We have a bid award, USDA Highway 29 Force Main Project. Doug?
Yes, Council, Mayor, that is the last of the USDA projects that we have to get awarded and get out to bid. Awarded. The bids have already been received. This is the low bidder. And so we're asking Council approval to sign the execute contract and get that project underway so that we can finish the last of our USDA projects.
This is the last one on the list?
This is the last one on the list.
Can you explain?
Yes, this is a force main replacement that goes between Bevins, actually starts in the shopping center and goes underneath Highway 29 and comes out on Parallel Drive. There's an existing conduit with an existing force main already there that we're using now, but its condition had come to the point where it had to be replaced, and we've opted to go with this type of a direct bore replacement versus trying to deal with going in and removing all of the old existing stuff that was in this concrete conduit. The engineers felt that this was a more affordable plan and that it would be quicker than trying to go in and remove all that old stuff and then re-plumb the old existing conduits.
Okay, any questions?
Doug, I know there was some conversation, I don't know exactly when it was, regarding Westside Community Park and bringing water under the freeway and you running like chases or something like that. Is any thought or any futuristic ideas about combining any projects, or is this just a straight force main? I'd say we're not going to do anything peripheral or anything like that.
Yeah, this is just a straight force main. I believe, well, there's several concepts that are out there. One is what they call the purple pipe, which is if you have a system that can treat tertiary, which is almost drinking water standard. We have looked at going tertiary with our sewer plant. The last time that was looked at by Mark Brannigan about 4 years ago was between $8 and $10 million to upgrade our plant to a tertiary plant.
We can't move forward to that.
So that one kind of got put on the back burner. The next thing that we looked at was the possibility of extending the raw water supply that goes into the water plant from the lake up to Westside Park. But when you did the math, it just didn't pencil out as far as a savings to the city.
There were some engineering issues with that too. We did have the engineer take a look at that, and the surface treatment plant would have to be down certain times in order for us to run this raw water from the lake out to the park. So there was issues with that. And then we thought that all the old sewer pipe was out there. We were just going to fit the line, but a lot of that's all missing. So it ended up being a much more complicated. Not to say that we wouldn't do that in the future, but it would take a lot more. Yeah, than we had anticipated when we did study going that route. So
I just hate to see us go through this trouble to do this boring and then say, oh, if we had just ran an electrical wire through there, we could have turned on lights over there or something like that.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the old conduit that the existing is will still be there.
Yeah.
And so that if at some point in time, if that becomes a feasible option, we still have that. That's
so we have that backup.
We still have that there. Okay. Yeah, we are not relinquishing that specifically for that reason. You don't want to shut a door if you don't have to.
Yeah, I think it's always good to be open-minded to some kind of, who knows what kind of new technology or something like that. Thank you, Dan.
You're welcome.
So what you're saying is we could use the old conduit to run another conduit, smaller one, through it and put something like telecom or whatever.
What would have to happen is the cost-benefit ratio would have to change so that it made it, you know, beneficial to use that old conduit.
For something.
Okay. Right. And if it was a matter of not having to remove a pipe when we're gonna run a smaller diameter pipe, say than the sewer line that we're running, which is a main, then we could possibly get it in that same conduit without removing the old sewer pipe, which would be ideal. But still, the cost-benefit ratio has to pencil out, and I don't see that in my lifetime after the studies that we just did on taking the raw water and trying to pipe raw water up there. Very expensive.
Any other questions? Anyone from the public? Okay, we have a suggested motion if there's no other discussion.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to authorize the city manager to sign the construction contract award for the Highway 29 Force Main project with Allen Gill Construction.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thanks, Doug.
You're welcome.
And next, we have a bid award for the former police station renovation. Chief, is this you?
No, this is going to be Mr. Greider.
Yeah. I got to find that.
Okay.
Give me 1 second to find that. I have to apologize. I've been out ill all last week, so I'm really playing catch up right now.
It's okay. I'm surprised how many non-responsive flooring companies.
I think the biggest thing with that is that the prevailing wage, a lot of smaller people aren't set up to do or to pay prevailing wage.
Okay.
And so I know for sure that that was an issue with one of our locals, and we really wanted to bid on it, that they just weren't willing or set up to do prevailing wage. Because there is reporting to the Fed on that and to the state. And so unfortunately, because it was prevailing wage, that precluded some people from being able to, precluded them wanting to bid on it.
Right, okay.
And, but as for, yeah, replacing the flooring and painting on the interior. And...
Did you find your report?
The internet here is not keeping up with my finger.
You got me to top up, Seth?
Yeah, Margaret, I really apologize.
No problem. So we went out, we had three bids, and the lowest bid for the floor covering with the prevailing wage, because you do have to do certified payroll, was $19,500. And that's basically the whole place. The flooring was really old, since before the police even moved in. They did do the patrol room in the concrete, but that has to be redone. And then the interior paint, we got three bids, and the lowest bid was $6,560 for the painting, and that's basically the whole building needed to be painted inside also. We do have a tenant, they have not signed a lease yet, but they are planning on moving in around the 15th of February, so we're kind of pushed to hurry up and get the flooring and the painting done so we can have it ready for them. They've been patiently waiting for about a year to move in, so they will be willing to get ready for them to move in by that date.
Okay. Any questions? Anyone from the public?
Who's moving into the building?
Are we saying who the new tenant is yet, or?
We do have a tenant. They don't, but they.
We don't.
I don't know if they've given notice to their landlord yet or not.
Oh no, we're not announcing that yet.
It's confidential.
So confidential still, but we'll know soon.
Name it just in case they haven't given their 30-day notice yet for their lease. But it will be 26. What was it?
The rent.
The rent.
Like $2,550 or $2,600 a month.
Yeah.
With this kind of apparent damage to the police station, are they going to be forfeiting their deposit?
Yes, the tenants that are leaving will be paying for this.
Okay, well, I guess that's okay. It sounds like a really bad renter. We have a $26,000 renovation after they leave. Wow.
I don't think that's what that is for you guys.
Well, in all honesty, I mean, we have carpets in there that have been in there for pushing 20 years, and the patrol room floor needs to be touched up, and the paint, most of the area hasn't been painted for close to 20 years as well. So
we appreciate the budget savings. Thank you, Chief.
Yes. Sorry about that.
I got tired of green shirt.
And this will offset about half of our new police station cost. Right.
Any other questions? Anyone from the public? Okay, we have a suggested motion.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to move to authorize the budget amendment to the amount of $26,060 to account 110-3033-990-000 for the tenant improvements, floor coverings, and interior paint. For the former Lakeport Police Station located at 916 North Fort Street.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, Council.
Do we get to pick the color?
Come see me, George.
Next, we have the Groundwater Sustainability Agency.
I think the front cover is closed.
I can't imagine how much this costs us to have to go through this.
Is this you, David?
This is me.
And the meter is still running.
We'll try to get you out of here soon. Some of you I know have to go to Sacramento. And some of us have to go to Grass Valley. So I know at least some of you are aware of legislation that was passed in 2014 to regulate groundwater in our state. We are the last state in the West to actually have comprehensive groundwater regulations. And this obviously was precipitated by the drought, because when there is a drought, it's groundwater that people turn to when their surface water dries up. And so I know some of you have some background in what this legislation is about, but I wanted to just give a brief overview. And I also have a staff report that is a little more comprehensive. And we're really coming up against some deadlines here soon, and so what I think staff is interested in is getting some direction. And also just explain briefly what we've been up to with respect to this. So I found this great template that has water droplets, and I thought was wonderful. So we're calling it SGMA, right? The Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. So the whole goal of this act is to maintain sustainable yields in our groundwater basins. So basically that's making sure that there's enough water in our basins to avoid undesirable results. A lot of the coastal groundwater basins have problems with seawater intrusion, where the groundwater gets so low that actually salt water intrudes into the groundwater, and it basically renders the groundwater completely useless, either for agriculture or for drinking water. There are huge parts of the Central Valley where there has been so much groundwater removed that the land actually subsided. So these are the kind of things that the SGMA is trying to prevent. So what it requires is for about 127 basins in our state to have what are called groundwater sustainability plans. And the 127 basins are determined by the Department of Water Resources, DWR, basins that they have found are high or medium priority basins. There are some basins that are completely exempt from SGMA because those have already been subject to court adjudication. So basically, there is no until SGMA, there was no regulation of groundwater other than when a groundwater user basically filed a lawsuit and demanded that the court adjudicate who has rights to how much water. So for those particular basins, SGMA doesn't apply. That doesn't apply to Lake County. So basin priority. This is a map that shows you the red areas are high priority basins as determined by the Department of Water Resources. So you'll see it's mainly the Central Valley, particularly the southern part of the Central Valley, and also in basins in Southern California, the red ones there. And then the orange are medium priority basins, and those are also going to be required to have a groundwater sustainability plan prepared by a groundwater sustainability agency. And I'll use my cool little laser, and I think somewhere over here is Lake County. And we have like 11 basins apparently in the county. Only two of them are actually designated as medium priority, and that's Scotts Valley, which we overlie, the city overlies, and then the Big Valley, which is just to the south here. And there are no other basins in the county that are designated high priority, and there's no other ones that are designated medium. Okay, so there are deadlines. The first big deadline, well, we have passed some deadlines, but the ones that are coming up that matter are at the end of June this year, you need to form your groundwater sustainability agency. And this is the agency that prepares the plan. And it's the agency that essentially manages and regulates the groundwater. This is the deadline to file with Department of Water Resources your election to groundwater sustainability agency. Then for some groundwater sustainability agencies, for critically overdrafted basins, they have till 2020 to develop their plan. So that's not us. That's nowhere in the county. The deadline that will apply here is the 2022 deadline, which will be the deadline to actually create the first groundwater sustainability plan. And I'll go in a little more depth later about what those plans are all about. If you don't meet one of these deadlines, then the state can take over and they can prepare the plan, which will involve determining what is the sustainable yield of the basin and helping to manage that. So these agencies that need to be formed will have a lot of powers, actually, and these are some of the main ones that they'll have. They'll be able to register wells and enforce spacing distances between wells. They will have fee authority, so they will be able to levy regulatory fees for permits or well registration, but they'll also be able to levy service fees, which would basically be a fee on the extraction of groundwater extraction fee. So for every acre foot of water that you pump, you'll have to pay the Groundwater Sustainability Agency a certain amount in order to cover costs associated with maintaining the basin. They can impose certain pumping allocations, manage polluted and wastewater. Obviously, they'll be dealing with the compliance and the monitoring. They will have enforcement authority, and they even have authority to increase replenishment activities. So this is like buying water from one place and then injecting it into your groundwater basin to help increase the groundwater levels, which they have to do a lot, especially like the places that have seawater intrusion. They have these huge injection wells where they pump in, often wastewater actually is what they'll use, to create like a hydrological wall between the seawater and the groundwater. Who can form a groundwater agency? Well, one or more local agencies that have water supply, water management, or land use responsibilities that overlie a groundwater basin. So you have to be a public agency in order to be a groundwater sustainability agency. The city has land use authority over its boundaries, and so it is able to be a groundwater sustainability agency. However, the DWR and SGMA limit the city's ability to be a GSA only to the extent of its service area. And that's true for all local agencies. So a local agency can only be the GSA to the extent, as far as its boundaries go. So that's why it can be one or more local agencies. You can have multiple local agencies come together through an MOU or a joint powers agreement. They can create essentially a new entity that has representation from all the local agencies. That entity could be the Groundwater Sustainability Agency for the entire basin, provided you've got agencies that have the land use or water supply authority that covers the entire basin that you're looking at. And in areas where there is no agency that has been declared the GSA, then the default is for the county to step in and be the GSA. Okay, so. All right, so how do you become a GSA? Well, it's actually not too difficult. Essentially, one of the main things that SGMA is interested in is getting all stakeholders involved. Even though the actual GSA is limited to public agencies, they have requirements that those agencies, the groundwater sustainability agencies, establish lists of people who are interested, stakeholders, so people who have surface water rights that would affect the groundwater. agricultural users of groundwater, you know, private well owners, obviously municipal groundwater users. And they want all those people to kind of have some kind of input. It doesn't necessarily have to be a vote, but so we need to establish a list of interested parties. We need to have a notice public hearing. And after that hearing, adopt a resolution declaring where the agency declares itself as the groundwater sustainability agency. It can also adopt some policies and procedures, rules for that agency. And then you submit it to DWR. They actually have like an online portal. At which point DWR will do this completeness review. Will they make sure that you've kind of ticked off all the boxes, that the map that you submit is correct, that you're not trying to extend your GSA beyond the boundaries of your service area. And then there's this 90-day period. This is all public. They post all this stuff on the DWR's website. And then within 90 days, anybody else who wants to be a GSA for that area needs to declare that they want to be the GSA. At which point, DWR will say, okay, nobody's in the GSA here. You two agencies need to go back to the drawing board and figure out how you want to fix this overlapping jurisdiction. Okay. And so that has happened quite a bit, actually. And you'll see if you look online, they've got a lot of these things happening. At which point, they'll come back, hopefully they'll reach some kind of conclusion, some kind of consensus, and then the GSA becomes effective. If nobody were to appear in the 90-day period, then that agency would be the de facto GSA, and then move forward from there. Alternatives to a groundwater sustainability agency. So there is sort of a little bit of wiggle room. You do not have to have a GSA if you can submit what's called an alternative plan. And these are some of the requirements for an alternative plan. Basically, you've got data, you've got metered data going back quite some time, and you can essentially demonstrate that your basin is in good health and is really not in such a bad state. So, I don't know if you guys are aware, but the county actually has recently submitted an alternative plan for both Scotts Valley Basin and Big Valley basins. So those were submitted prior to January 1. They've now been posted, and there's a 60-day comment period. But according to DWR, it'll take them about 2 years at least to determine whether or not the alternative plan is sufficient. So you'll have to wait for the answer to see whether or not.
Deadlines will be over.
Right. Meanwhile, if you recall, there's a June 30th deadline of this year to declare that you want to be a GSA. So we won't know whether or not the Scotts Valley Basin doesn't need to be a GSA until long after the deadline for the city to ask for the GSA has passed. And recall, it's the county that is the default GSA. So were the city to allow the time to pass, the June 30th date to pass, without declaring that it was the GSA, then if in 2 years DWR says, you know what, your alternative plan wasn't sufficient, there's not enough data for Scotts Valley Basin, then it's possible that they would say, so county, you're the GSA because nobody filed by June 30th, 2017.
So question on that.
Sure.
You said that if there were two different groups that both filed to be the GSA, they would send it back to us and go, hey, you guys need to work this out. Are they going to do something similar if the county has already sent in an alternative plan that we submit to be the GSA?
That's a good question. I don't read the statute to say that. They only send it back when there's two entities that declare to be the GSA over overlapping. There's nothing in there about, it's not about alternative plans.
My question is, what advantage does the city have by becoming a GSA and not letting the county do the alternate. If they don't make it, then they are the GSA.
Right. Well, let me finish this. And I mean, some of it had to do with the powers that a GSA has. I'm almost done actually. So this is what these are the requirements of a groundwater sustainability plan, more or less. Essentially, it's a report that includes historical data about groundwater levels, quality, projects demands, and makes plans on a really long scale, long-term basis for how to ensure that the basin remains healthy and within a sustainable yield. And the DWR is needs to review and approve those. So this is a map that Mr. Ingram was able to put together. And it shows you more or less the boundaries of the Scotts Valley groundwater basin as determined by DWR, okay, which is this area. And then the red line is the city limits. So this is essentially the extent of the GSA that the city could form if it wanted to. And then these dots over here, which could be bigger, but luckily I have my laser. These are the locations of the city's wells. So they're not within the city's boundaries, they're outside. So the entity that's gonna be the GSA, that's gonna govern this area will have the ability to impose fees on extraction of groundwater. It will also, as I mentioned before, it'll have the power to impose well regulations and registration requirements, things like that. Those are the types of things that the GSAs have the power to do. So what the city was originally looking at was working with the county to form a joint powers authority that included the county and the city that would then be the GSA for the entire Scotts Valley Basin. And so we actually drafted an agreement, but the county has since moved forward with this alternative plan. And at this point, we're actually not sure that it appears that what they're planning on doing is they would want to be, if their alternative plan doesn't work, that they would be looking at creating one GSA that would cover the entire county. And that would give the city a role on an advisory with respect to what the GSA is going to do regarding management of the groundwater basin. So, we wanted, our original intent was to talk to them, come to a conclusion about how we can regulate the groundwater together. And because, if two entities are going to form a GSA with the same territory, we're still going to have to get together and solve it. So, better to try to solve it earlier than later. Unfortunately, we haven't had the feedback from the county at this point that's the route they want to go. So because we have this deadline coming up, there's a decision that needs to be made, which is, A, do we get involved in the GSA business at all? And B, if we do, how do we go about it? Do we continue to try to work with the county with this deadline looming? Or do we move forward on looking into actually forming the GSA to the extent we can so that we can at least get a spot at the table? Or do we try to do both simultaneously? Hopefully that we get the county to work with the county and get something prepared before June. And if not, we'll have a resolution ready to go to form GSA on our own. So that's kind of where we are now, and that's why Margaret asked me to give some background on this and get some feedback and input on where we want to go. Happy to answer questions.
Well, I just see this as all of a sudden the county doesn't actually want to be a GSA because they put in the alternative plan, so that they're kind of like don't want to talk about it. Partner of being a GSA. Can somebody talk to Tina Scott, who is the representative for this area, and find out if she has any new information. Do they feel like they might be interested in this?
We have been working with staff from the county on this, and we were working together and had discussed moving forward with the JPA and kind of had determined that David would start working on that. And the next thing we knew is they already had adopted going the other direction with the alternative plan. And they said at that meeting that they're going to do the alternative plan and apply for countywide GSA. So they already had taken a different direction. So I have not talked to Tina Scott, so I will reach out to her. I kind of wanted to see where county council wanted to go with this, and then I would have that discussion with her as to what county what council direction to us was. But
because what I see here is because our wells are not within our sphere of influence, no matter what we say, they're going to have power over those. I mean, whether we become a GSA or not, they're going to have power over those two wells.
That's not how it works. Well, it could happen that way. We don't know for sure yet, but if we put in our GSA mm-hmm. application and they put their GSA application in, then DWR, as David mentioned, would ask us to work together on it. And there's been some changes to the plan where it hasn't been, I don't know if it's been tested yet or not, how much power that just the county would have versus, you know, working together with us at JPA. So, and we, about 100% of our water in the wintertime comes from those wells. So it is very substantial. A concern to us is to at least having a seat at the table to discuss, right, you know, not just be advisory, but also be a joint powers with them on that water.
And the other thing that's worth mentioning is that we actually have an agreement with Yolo County that ensures that we have 750 acre feet from the basin, which is our historical allotment. So another thing that the city wants to make sure is that allocation is secure and protected.
The thing that was apparent to me, I think Stacy was at one of the League of Cities opportunities that we had, and they actually had the head of the Department of Water Resources, I don't know if you got a chance to go to that one, had some really scary photos of subsidence and all kinds of horrible scenarios. And quite frankly, as a prudent citizen of the state of California, I was shocked and dismayed to find out that we hadn't had something like this 50 years ago. I mean, this is like maybe even 100 years overdue, but at least 50, and this needs to be done. But when you see, and of course they formed it right in the middle of the biggest, you know, 7-year crisis, and there was some just appalling areas of, but the big thing that came out of it was the head of the Department of Water Resources had no clues about what was going on. They knew some of the terminology, the GSA, the GSP, they had a fancy name, you know, Sigma, and that was about all they knew. And they still are finding their way, and a lot of this stuff is very experimental, and that's why you're seeing the deadlines that are out there, you know, 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 years out there, because there's a lot of stuff that needs to be tested, and the kind of problem that we're having with the county is minimal. When you're in the San Joaquin Valley and they're drawing out of the same aquifer as the county next door, and they have to try and figure out who's going to be on the GSA and who's going to determine who can overpump and who can't, you know, feed this particular orchard or vineyard or these cattle, it's a real quagmire. And I think that this thing is going to be a very highly contested issue throughout California. I think ours is relatively small, but I would say that it's absolutely essential that if the county gets the GSA, if we don't get the alternative plan, and they have power over fees and pumping allocations and stuff like that, that could be all bad for the city of Lakeport if we end up in some kind of a, you know, relationship that's less congenial to someone like, you know, Farrington or something. But anyway, the whole thing is, I think we need to hold everything fast so that we can make sure that we had a seat at the table if it's countywide. But I think the best thing to do, like our fellow council member pointed out, if we both apply for the GSA, we have to work it out, and we need to be in that position, I believe.
The one positive thing about, well, lots of positive things, but one of the really positive things is that these wells have actually, our water has actually risen instead of dropped. The type of, over the years, even during the drought, because the type of agriculture, the flood irrigation that used to be done with the walnuts and the pears, we hardly have any walnuts and pears in South Valley. And they're using a lot more smarter irrigation now too. So actually our table's gone up instead of gone down. So that's a good thing. That's why the alternative plan might work, because that's one of the things too, it doesn't show that we're degrading the water, you know, supply there. So that, you know, that's a real positive. But, you know, as you said, it's really important to have some control of it.
Yeah, I don't think staff has a problem with the alternative plan. The problem is these crazy deadlines that the legislature has imposed, so that we essentially need to, if we want to go the alternative plan route, we either need to waive our right to ever be DGSA, or we need to make the claim that we need to do, and then in the event that the alternative plan is approved, you can withdraw your election to be GSA. You can always withdraw your election to be GSA.
Well, I still think that some of these deadlines may in themselves be challenged, because it's such a complicated mess out there. It's great that we're moving forward, but I think that the Department of Water Resources is in for some very exciting times, because I think there's going to be lawsuits. It's going to be a very litigious situation, especially in these areas where they have overlapping and who's going to decide who gets what, how much, and when, and pumping allegations and stuff like that, and contiguous areas that are using the same basin. It's just going to be a nightmare.
I was actually involved in, because only local agencies can be the Groundwater Sustainability Agency, I was involved in some LAFCOs in the Central Valley where it was a group of farmers, well owners, who went out and formed a water district just so that they could become and announce that they were GSA. It was the sole purpose of the district. So it's
going to be really controversial, because on a smaller scale, you have to remember property owners across the state have their own wells that no one has told them what to do, how much they can use, how much they can't use. But when this starts to trickle down to those property owners and they realize that someone's going to tell them how much water they can use, it might be a problem. And just a few years ago, the state tried to change the rules for septic systems. And they called a meeting down, it was towards Santa Rosa. The freeways all backed up so far that traffic just stopped down there. They had to cancel the meeting and end it. And that was the end of that. So this, without the pressure of a major drought going on, this could head in that same direction once it trickles down to the people realizing this is going to infringe on their use of their well, that they think it's their water on their property. So it's a big thing, but in the meantime, we need to protect our water basin, because that's where we get all of our water for our city most of the year. So if the county decided to go a different route, then it's important. It's imperative that we protect ourselves now. Any other questions? Anyone from the public? Come on up.
Hello, my name's Greg Scott, Scott's Valley Road. The questions I have, of course, I live out there in the middle of that use of water, and I use my water very frugally, and like I'm always in a drought. I want that well to last me the rest of my life, and I'm sorry. But my question is on one of these things. When you focus ahead, are there any groups in California or other places that have experience of how these things are working out over the years? For example, if you're collecting fees, is the county going to collect the fees for the city because they are the lead organization, or are you going to be able to get your own fees? Who's going to be staffing and going out and collecting the penalties or inspections of wells? Is the city going to do that with more staff? Is the county going to do that? Who's going to be burdened with all the costs of these staffing as this comes? As resources get tighter, you think gasoline costs us a lot, wait till you see what water may someday cost us. And so between education and preparing to move forward with what you're looking at here, maybe there are other organizations or entities that have done this for 5-10 years that have things worked out, and maybe they might be able to share some light.
This is brand new.
Brand new legislation.
It's 2014, nobody knew what was going on.
Let me tell you, I worked for the state for 35 years. You let the state take over, maybe that's your problem.
And part of the fees that they're allowed to charge, whoever is the GSA, is to carry out the plan, which means monitoring the wells and doing all those things. So those fees would go back to who uses the water in that area.
Well, I just don't want you to skip over on your fees or your registration things.
Yeah, but there's no detail right now as to what those fees would be, you know. Nobody knows yet what that, how that's gonna work yet.
A lot of the fee authority actually doesn't even come into play until there is a groundwater sustainability plan that's been accepted. Because it's the plan is what establishes how much water can be extracted to maintain safe yield.
That's 2022.
In until 2022.
Thanks, Greg. Nathan, do you want to come up?
Nathan Maxman. I just had a question. If you guys choose to form a GSA and then the alternative plan is accepted by the state, how does that work exactly? Does your GSA automatically get withdrawn? Or do you, like, if the county is applying also, as you had stated, they were applying for a countywide one, and then the alternative plan is accepted, does the GSA go away, or do you guys have to decide to put the GSA aside?
I think we have to decide to withdraw the GSA.
Okay, thank you.
This is, like, David, correct me if I'm wrong, that if the alternative plan is approved by DWR, its basic effect is that we would no longer be considered a medium priority basin, correct?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if we officially get removed from that list, but you wouldn't need the GSA structure. And to go back to Greg's thing, as far as the fees, the GSA is the one that would be responsible for those fees, which is all the more reason that we need to make sure that we're at the table.
That's right. The GSA is going to be a separate entity.
Right.
And that's the entity that has the fee-making authority.
And that unfortunately was the most alarming thing that came out of the county's thing, was that they kind of wanted to form one for the entire county, and whether, you know, on purpose or not, it essentially would relegate the city to an advisory capacity, but not an actual voting capacity at the board level. And that was a big issue for us, and I think that's one of the reasons bringing it before you guys tonight as well.
A question on that. The city has put in their alternative plan. Have they also...
The county did.
I'm sorry, the county. Have they also put in to be a GSA?
They said at their board meeting that that's where they were going to do the application for the GSA, because if the alternative plan didn't get accepted, and they won't know for a long time, the GSA has to be in by June 17th of this year, June 30th, 2017 this year, then they were going to go ahead and do a GSA for the whole county.
So they've announced that intent, but they have not filed something with DWR.
So then really, for us to even get a seat at this table, we need to file for a GSA so that they have to work with
at least,
us,
yeah,
in theory.
Right.
Exactly.
Because if we're the two separate entities both filing for the same GSA, then they're I hate to put it this way, but they're forced into a situation where they have to work with us.
Right. Anyone else? Did you have a question, George?
No, I was just gonna say, do we need a
motion?
We do, yeah. I think the public's
spoken. Ready. Really, we're just looking for direction. I think I just wrote a suggested motion just because it's cleaner and it makes the minutes staff.
We like it that way.
Staff figure out what happened.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to move to direct the staff to initiate the formation of a groundwater sustainability agency for the area of the Scotts Valley Basin within the city service area, and bring back dates for a public hearing on a resolution to form a GSA.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thanks, David. That was good.
That was
presentation.
Brilliant. Good job. Yeah, I think
there was a lot of this. I did not reinvent the wheel.
I don't know.
Is that part of the normal retainer?
That's what that goes in your retainer.
Those water spot graphics have had to have sent us back something.
That you can thank Bill Gates and just templates.
I still didn't see the red. It was brown.
Which one?
First slide, it was brown, not red.
Depends on your color perspective.
Yeah, it looked red on the screen down
it's
here.
Down there.
Is it red down
it
there?
It was
on
red
the screen.
Down here. Are you
talking about the boundaries?
No, the one with the
high priorities.
Where the,
the
ballot.
Right there.
That one.
You mean the.
Let's give them a hard time.
Do we have that in our
red and gold?
This you do not.
Direct
can put it.
We paid for that.
Water sustainability, so to speak. For the area of the Scotts Valley Basin.
Hopefully it copyrighted it.
No, it's on the screen, it shows. It's just the way it transmits from our projector.
Okay. You can
well, we can put it in Dropbox.
Yeah.
Why don't we, we're gonna back up. We have a clarification question. Within the motion, Councilmember Barnes is pointing out it's for the Scotts Valley Basin within the city service area.
Right, as I mentioned, you can only form a GSA over the territory that is contiguous with your service area.
Right.
So we can only form a GSA over the red line in the Scotts Valley Basin, which is the city's boundary. If we were to form a GSA and say, oh, we're the GSA for the entire Scotts Valley Basin, DWR would say, your application is incomplete, you are not the GSA, do it again.
Yeah.
So basically we're becoming the GSA for that small for the portion
right,
of the city.
The subsection of it.
And then the county would come in and could be the GSA for all the surrounding area.
That's a possibility.
Good.
That could get interesting.
Still could be interesting.
All right. That's fun.
And in that case, it's a good question because in that case, there's different ways to create the plan, the GSP. You can have both GSAs work to create one GSP, or you can actually have separate GSPs, but they have to be coordinated. So there will be more regulations that will discuss that as DWR gets to.
Got it.
But the alternative plan looks pretty good at this point with our rising levels and the reduction of use in Scotts Valley.
That's the best scenario.
The best scenario is
and this all may be a moot point, but we want to cover ourselves.
Exactly.
If there's a table, we want to be at it.
Correct.
All right. City Council of Communications. So you guys are heading out tonight, so we'll keep this moving. Margaret, do you have anything?
No further comment.
David?
Any reports?
Finance. We have two of you. Anything tonight?
No.
We're just getting ready for this next wave of storms that's supposed to be coming in. Well, it's actually supposed to start tonight. The heaviest rains are supposed to be on Sunday. So we're just getting ready for that. Lake's coming up, 7 feet.
Oh.
So at 9 feet, that's when we really got to start worrying. So.
Thanks,
Doug.
You're welcome.
So we're going to get wet moving on Sunday and Monday.
Yes. We are.
Oh, that's right.
I can't change the date, so we're moving forward. But on communications, I just wanted to let council know, I believe you've heard it or seen it in prior briefings, that one of my priorities this year for the police department is increasing traffic enforcement. Not in the interest to write more tickets, but to change the behavior of drivers who are driving unsafely or violating traffic laws. So we just got that started last week. Last week, our target area, which I'm announcing these on social media to the public every week, what the target area is, because I think, you know, getting the word out and educating people, maybe some people think about I need to drive safely, that helps. But last week, 11th Street was the target area. I believe we had 7 moving violations and sight on a suspended driver and one arrested DUI just in that target area. So I just put out tonight the target area for starting tomorrow will be Hartley Street between the city limits and Clear Lake Avenue, where we've received a number of complaints about dangerous driving. So this is gonna be going on throughout the year, and just because the target area might be Hartley this week doesn't mean that officers still won't be back patrolling 11th Street or other areas of the city. It just means that that's an area that we're going to spend extra time on each week that this goes out. And I advise the Traffic Safety Council about these plans, and I want to keep the word out to the public as much as possible that traffic safety is a major priority. And we're going to be working with all the other departments because it comes into play with what they're doing, also with the grants on improving roadway striping, safe routes to schools and whatnot. So just want to keep everybody aware of that.
Kevin?
Nothing to report.
Kelly?
No report.
Councilmember Spur?
In my first Main Street Association meeting today at noon, and we were talking to organization that's going to bring a bass tournament here in March, April, but they're going to be based out of the Conocti Vista Casino, but they've already got the hotels all set up here, and they're kind of like booked, and so they're trying to get, according to him, he likes Lakeport better, so they're going to think about moving it to Lakeport next year, but it's too late this year to do it. And so the Main Street's going to give them a little bit of money to help them with their endeavors. So it would be nice if they could get them over here. So I remember when they had the ESPN thing, that mm-hmm. everybody came downtown and seen all that.
Yeah.
It made everybody have a good time. So it would be nice if they could do it.
Councilmember Carlet?
We had a non-meeting meeting with the abandoned vehicle abatement. Someone neglected to notice the meeting, so rather than have Brown Act violations, we could not come to any consensus except that we were having a meeting on Monday to try and figure out how we're going to deal with the banned vehicles and separate the money that's already been in there, and we're going to start using the money that's being collected by the DMV and so forth. So this is something that we've been all looking forward to for a long time, so we're really kind of excited about that. Jeff Smith's very anxious to get this going because we all need to do that. I would like to just point out to the people that are going to Sacramento that I'm envious. It's the League of Cities puts on some of the best seminars, has some of the best speakers. As I said, the Department of Water Resources director was there. They have the head. Other times from one of the most inept people I've ever seen was the head of PERS. I got a chance to listen to him. But anyway, there's some great seminars there. And what I like to do is, it's good to go together, but sometimes it's good to maybe tag team these and then share your information. But it's a wonderful opportunity. I think you're going to find that the California League of Cities is one of the best things that ever happened to local politics. And I wish you well, and have a good time there, and take advantage of every minute that you're there, including the interactions and all of the different get-togethers at the different caucuses. You'll find that our city manager is extremely well-connected, and it's because of the various get-togethers that they have. And then when she has a problem, she can talk to other people, use the opportunity to talk to people in the meetings, say where you're from and you know what you do, and collect business cards and stuff, because you never know when you might need these people. And Margaret's done it, and I'm sure David probably has too, consult with other people and solve problems and not reinvent the wheel like we were talking about. Greg was talking about having a plan. Well, in this case, he didn't have a plan, but a lot of times they do. And so it's a great opportunity, and I think you're going to find that every time you go to one of these, you're going to be a better city council member and a better leader of the community. So good luck and have fun.
Well said. Councilmember Barnes?
Well, I went to my first fire protection district meeting. Showed up promptly at 6 o'clock as I was instructed, and was told the meeting was at 5. So it was the quickest meeting I have ever been in my life. It was fun. I got looked at like, hey, who are you? I'm the new city council guy. Hi.
And you're late.
Sorry about that.
Late. No, it was fine, you know. But now I know it's at 5. So I will be there at the next one. I plan on reviewing the minutes as soon as they're posted so I can see what happened at that meeting. But so there was that. That was a good time. So that's all I've got.
Okay. The LAPCO meeting's tomorrow in Clear Lake at 9:30. I'll be at the housing meeting down in SAC. I'll see you guys at our division meeting. And that is it. Thanks for coming. Meeting adjourned.